As I mentioned in part three, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put together two videos from older videos that I did on 66 class bobbin case positioning brackets and bobbin cases, put it together, and then we're going to get into using this little puppy. So stand by. Kat Zimmerman sent me an email today. She was having problems with a bobbin case positioning bracket on her 66. You know, one of these. Got Liz sitting here with me.
Hello, everybody.
And it is New Year's Eve. It is 11:25 p.m. We just read Kat's email and we're like, oh my God, a damsel in distress. Let's fix this. Let's help Kat out. So what I'm going to do is I'm sitting here taking apart, completely disassembling, a bobbin case positioning bracket. Yes. And in answer to your question, which I know you've got, no. Before this evening, I never completely disassembled one of these before. But because Kat had a problem, we're all over it like a cheap suit. Anyway, Kat, the reason why... Oh, let me explain to everybody. Kat had taken the bracket, the ejector button off because she wanted to clean schmoo. Kat, the reason why you couldn't get this back in place, you need to have this spring off to make it work, and I'll show you why. Let's take a look first at what the spring looks like. All right? We have the coil spring. It's got an arm coming off. It's got a second arm coming off that has a hooky thing on it. All right? You can see that, I presume. Okay. Now, that is going to go onto the ejector arm. And how it goes on is the hooky end goes around the area of the presser arm, and then the pointy portion of the spring points up. Okay? Here's the trick. To get this on the bracket, you'll see... let me set stuff down.
Yes.
I don't have that many hands. I need more hands. And it's bad enough that I still am having problems with the monoclonal. I've got like zero sense of touch in my right hand. But you see on the bracket there's this groove? Well, that groove is hidden by this spring. The portion of the coil spring, that little arm, that's got to go in this groove, Kat. So this is how we're going to do it. All right? Now, I'm pushing the part that wraps around the arm, I'm pushing that up initially to get this on and then letting it come down, and that puts that little piece of the spring through that arm or into that groove. Now I'm going to take the hooky part in the back and I'm going to pull it downward while I work the rod with the screw into the spring. Caught my finger there. Now it's going through the spring that way, and in order to do that you really do need to pull this little portion, that hooky thing, pull it down tight. That forces the coil of the spring into such a position that you can get the rod easily through there, tighten the screw, and then the rest of it is just like Lego. Although I've never seen Lego that uses screws. It's not going to snap together. All right, we're going to put this spring on first, the spring that's going to hide everything. I got to confess, kids, this is not the first time we shot this video. We shot this video starting at 11 o'clock. Took it into shot the whole thing, took it into post-production. I said to Liz, I can do this faster, better, with a better explanation. Let's go back and reshoot it. All right, I'm going to put that post back in. I'm going to put the arm on. And the last piece that we're going to put on is the screw of death. Now, of course, this is not going to be adjusted. That'll have to get adjusted when it goes into a machine. Like I said, these are spare parts for me. I've got a couple of extra of these positioning brackets. So let's get that back on. Let's run the screw of death back down. and then we'll put the spring with the felt back in place. I did a video on replacing this felt just a few days ago, so I will refer you back to that. All right, now the first time we shot this video, Liz, it ran 9 minutes 33 seconds. We're at 5:06. Ta-da! And that included disassembly.
Very good.
I think we deserve a cookie.
Any of you who've ever worked on a 99 or a 66 and had a nasty bobbin case like this, you tried to clean it. I mean, there's a lot of rust on this. So, how do you get it apart? More importantly, how do you get it back together again? There is a spring right here that the thread actually goes underneath. And this is the tension adjusting screw for that spring. So it's kind of important how you get these devices apart and back together again. So I'm going to hold in my little machinist vise. I've got the machinist vise on a stand at the moment. It's not really tight on the stand, as you can see. It's kind of flopping. It's just holding it in basic position. So I'm going to take this apart. Start with this little tiny screw up top. And I'm going to grab the screw as it comes out with a pair of tweezers. Set it off to the side. And then I'm going to loosen up the adjusting screw and take the adjusting screw out as well. And yes, this does mean that this is going to have to be adjusted after it's cleaned and reassembled. But I want you to see what you don't see when you just look at these things when it's in place. I got the screw off. Okay, now here's the leaf spring. Let's get the leaf spring out of the way. I'm going to try to do this with tweezers to keep my fat paws out of the way. There's the leaf spring. I'll set that down for the moment. And here's what was underneath that. See all that rust and crud in there? Hold on, let me get a screwdriver. All that rust and crud, that would have been completely missed had I not taken that apart. Let's look on the back of the spring. Back of the spring is just as bad, filled with rust and crud. Now I'm hoping I can clean this well enough so that this spring is going to be reusable. Question of the hour, how to clean this. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put the spring, those two little screws, in a container so that they don't get lost. They're tiny. My weapon of choice is going to be a rotary tool, and we're going to get in there with this style hard felt and get those on Amazon. So I'm going to use yellow compound. We're going to get in here and we're going to polish this. Yellow compound is what I use on the buffing wheels, my bench polishers. I normally, when I'm working with the Dremel, use white. And honestly, this is the first time I've used yellow with the Dremel, and I'm liking what I'm seeing. And I'm using Dremel as a, same way one would use Kleenex. It's a rotary tool. I know, this is not a Dremel. This is a Harbor Freight. And if you're wondering why I use the Harbor Freight one, it's because they're essentially disposable. At this price point, I can have a bunch of them. And I do. I've got like three or four of these. And I keep on expecting them to die. This one I was ready to retire. I've been using this one for a couple of years. I was ready to retire it the other day. And it just refuses to give it up. It's a little noisier than I'd like, but it's okay. All right, let's wipe off some of the excess schmoo here. Oh, that's cleaning up nicely. There's still a little bit of crud buried, but we'll take care of that and get the extraneous. See how that's all been polished in there. This is coming up quite nicely. The areas that I had feared weren't going to polish, weren't going to clean up, are cleaning up very, very well. These hard felt polishing wheels that I buy from Amazon really are marvelous for this detail work. And yes, the compound does go black. That's okay. And man, does this get hot. And that's okay too. See how I'm using this hard felt polishing point to get in all the recesses. And honestly, that doesn't really matter. That's just a matter of, these don't really, they're not in the thread path. This is just personal pride in getting stuff clean. Fortunately, there's no rust down in the groove. All right, let's wipe this down a little bit more. I just really, really like to restore parts to get them looking really, really nice. And like I said, this is not a customer machine I'm working on. This is a personal project. I have so many of these 99s that I've bought over the past several years. I know I rail about people hoarding featherweights, and I've got a bunch of those as well. Between my wife and I, we have four or five featherweights in the house. I'd have to go looking. I don't remember exactly, but I have a special place in my heart for the 99. I think, honestly, it's represents the best value in a vintage machine. Price versus performance, that you really can't beat them. Let me get some yellow compound on this. Okay. Let's get in here and clean this up. That is getting warm. Friction is our friend, I guess. Let's get the schmoo out. Get into the crevices. That's why these wooden-handled swabs are just wonderful to work with. And You can't overestimate the value of a clean and polished bobbin case. This is the beginning of half of your thread path. Well, unless you got a chain stitch machine where you're not running a bobbin, but for any lock stitch machine, you know, keeping your thread path clean and polished is kind of really important. If you want it to be as smooth as possible, no burrs, no crud. So, yeah, some people think I'm a little crazy going to the extent that I do. But I've never had anybody complain that their thread path was too clean. All right, let me set this aside and pull out this spring. Now, the inside of the spring has a bunch of corrosion here. I'm going to go back to the smaller felt buffer. And I'm going to recharge it with some fresh compound. Next step, how to secure this. Let me find I'll use my small non-marring pliers. Hold that this way. These pliers have a nylon jaw. They're from Beadsmith. They are nylon jawed and they don't mark up anything. And was I successful? Yes. You can see I got all the crap that was inside in the thread path of this cleared out. And just for grins and giggles, I'm going to do the outside portion of this too. Because why not? Flip it around. There. Now, shall we reassemble it? Let's get our ducks in a row here. I'm going to put the spring in its proper orientation back onto the bobbin case, thusly, and I'm going to secure the bobbin case lightly but secure, light but firm, get it secured in my little vise just as a work holding fixture. Okay, now I need the larger of the two screws, and I'm going to start that screw up just a little bit. Don't breathe. Okay, I got that one started. Now I'm going to take the smaller of the two screws. Actually, I'm going to get that a little bit more upright. And set the screw down. Okay. Okay, I got the screw started. That screw is tiny. It's probably like an 080 or something like that. And now we'll get the tensioner in. And we'll mess with the bobbin case tension when the machine is back together again and we're reinstalling it. But there you go. If you remember what this bobbin case looked like when I started, this is a tremendous difference. And I think we have brought this back from death and destruction. So I'm quite pleased.
Okay, I think that pretty much explains how to do the bobbin case positioning bracket in the bobbin case. I also cleaned up and reinstalled the upper thread tension mechanism. It's no different than any other basic simple one you guys have seen. I'm not going to shoot, you know, I didn't bother to get that on video either. Now, I still haven't done the bobbin winder, but once again, I've got a dozen bobbin winder videos out there. It's a standard 66 type bobbin winder. It's nothing that we haven't already shot. So what we're going to do is we're going to do some stitching. And you'll notice there's no motor on this machine. There's a hand crank. Well, yes, this machine came with a motor, but she was made in 1918, and that is long before Singer started putting motors on these machines, about 5 years before. So, yeah, I'm going to do this with a hand crank on it. Now, this is a cheap Chinese copy. It's made out of Chinesium. It's not great, but it works. And I'm going to give a little demo with her stitching with a hand crank. Now, as with all machines, always try to hold your tails for the first couple of stitches. Okay, tails were held, first couple stitches are in. Now, if you want to lock those stitches, when you have this up, you can always raise the presser foot back up and bring the needle down and go back in the same starting hole, and then just start stitching. And I've got a pretty long stitch length selected here. Get the needle down. I'm going to shorten that up a couple of turns. That's quite a few turns, actually. Now you get 3 stitches for every rotation of the hand wheel. Turning a corner. Bada bing, bada boom. There we go. Always bury your needle, of course, when you're turning corners. You do that with electric-powered machines as well. And here we go. We'll just stitch away happily until my arm falls off. I'm an electric motor kind of guy. I'm doing rounded corners on this. My buddy Meredith, she's a big fan of hand crank machines. She's part of the reason why I'm doing the demo with a hand crank, because we were talking last night and I mentioned I'd put a hand crank on this. And she got a good laugh out of that because she knows I'm a motor guy. So Meredith, this one's for you. Let me shorten those stitches up a bit more. And yeah, even with a cheap Chinese hand crank, oh God, that's exhausting. Lengthen those up a bit. Yeah, I'm going to have an arm like a freaking eggplant by the time I'm done with this. Now, a lot of people, when they're running their machines, they run way too much presser foot pressure. I tend to run it a little light, which makes it easy to steer to do this kind of garbage. Just make patterns in the fabric here. Well, this is actually lint-free paper towel that I'm stitching onto. But it's 4 layers of it. Yeah, this is no way to live. This is why we have electric motors, kids. Alright, I'm gonna get off of this. Alright. Pull that out. And you can see she's stitching just fine. My arm's going to be sore for a week if I keep that up. But yeah, so she's stitching great. And no, I didn't have to readjust the timing. I actually hit the timing. I hit the nail right on the head. I don't know how I did that. Like I said in the last episode of this series. But anyway, that's what I've got on a 99 for Sandra. As I mentioned in part 3, Sandra actually wound up with a different
99, not this one, because she wanted one that had, not only was motorized, which this would have been, but she really wanted one with back tack, so I had one from like the late 50s that I did up for her real quick that shipped the other day. But anyway, thank you so much for watching. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep this machine or not. I will finish up the bobbin winder and everything. This one might go up for sale. Not sure. If it does, it'll go up on my website. But thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.